This series has been going on for over 2 years now. And I'm not gonna lie, it was hard to find the motivation to keep going at times. Thoughts of doubt often niggled at the back of my brain, but every time, one factor pulled me back in. That being, this video. Shitting on the bad parts of Pokemon may have been the reason I started this series, but getting to praise the parts I love is why I kept with it. I'm gonna go ahead and be entirely transparent here. I have something of an emotional attachment to Pokemon Sun and Moon. It's gonna be hard letting go of that, but to review them properly, I'm gonna try my damnedest to do so. That being said, I do genuinely believe there's an explanation for why I have so many fond memories of my time playing Sun and Moon, beyond blind nostalgia. Even when the game first came out, it was the most fun I'd ever had playing Pokemon. So today, I'm picking them back up to try and see if there's a reason for that. Putting all biases aside, let's go through and analyze my umpteenth journey across the Alola region. I start off by answering a call from Professor Kukui and telling him that my name is Shitpost. After an in-person visit from Kukui, he takes us to the Kahuna to get our starter Pokemon. But when I get into Iki Town, I instead find this blonde girl carrying a bag and curiously follow her to a sketchy bridge above a gorge. Suddenly, a Pokemon, apparently named Nebby, leaps from the girl's bag and finds itself in trouble on the bridge. I go out to help it, but the bridge ends up collapsing. Right before me and Nebby die, Tapu Koko saves us and drops a sparkling stone on its way out. Me and the girl make it back to town, where we find Kukui, who identifies her as his assistant, Lily. Finally, we meet the Kahuna, Hala, and he gives us our starter Pokemon, Popplio, which I name Sari. On my way back to see my mom, I run into a very excitable kid named Hal, who challenges me to a Pokemon battle with my new partner. Afterwards, Hala notices the stone we picked up earlier and promises to give it back to us at the festival tomorrow. One good night's rest later, and we're at the festival where we once again beat Hal, and Hala gives us back our stone, which he crafted into a Z bracelet. Another good night's rest later, and we get Rotom Dex at the professor's lab, officially starting our island challenge alongside Hal. My next order of business is to clear through the trainer school, so I do exactly that, and move into Howley City. Down at the marina, I find these goons called Team Skull trying to steal Pokemon from the trial captain, Alima. We fight them off, and Alima challenges us to a battle to see if we're ready for his trial. Doing exactly that, I make my way to Verdant Cavern. Me and Sari get to the cavern and begin our first trial. At the end was Totem Raticate, which I defeated to both clear the trial and obtain Normalium Z. Next up is the Grand Trial, so I loop my way back around the island and have another battle against Hal on the way. Upon facing and beating Hala, I get Phytanium Z from him, and we befriend a Tauros and ride on its back down to the marina. When I get there, I head off to Akala Island with Hal, Lily, and Kukui. Landing on Akala, we're greeted by the Kahuna, Olivia, and a trial captain, Mallow. Everyone goes off to do their own thing, except me and Hal make our way up to the water trial together. On our way, we fight against each other and this edgy Team Skull associate named Gladion. I finally reach the water trial, and after being knocked out once by Totem Wishiwashi, I come back and defeat it to pass Lana's trial. With that out of the way, I go down, take a detour at the Battle Royal Stadium, and end up at Well of Volcano for my next trial. There, I catch my second team member, a Cubone named Windabone. With Windabone, I easily clear Kiawe's Fire Trial. I head up through Route 8 and catch a Stuffle, which I nicknamed Taxidermy. After a while, I finally arrive at Mallow's trial, where I struggle against Totem Lurantis. Eventually, because of an evolved Taxidermy, I'm able to beat it. Kukui greets us outside the lush jungle and tells me to meet him at the Dimensional Research Lab in Hiahia City, so I do. Once I get there, the professor's wife, Burnett, tells us about a phenomenon called Ultra Wormholes, and we learn more about Lily and Nebby, aka Cosmog. Next, I trek down into Diglett's Cave, where I see Olivia alongside this group called Team Aether, who are working to protect Pokemon and their habitats. I make it out of the cave after a brief encounter with Team Skull and end up in Coney Coney City. From there, I head to the Ruins of Life to meet Olivia. On the way, however, I run into Team Aether having a bout with Team Skull. I help Aether rid of the Skull Grunts, and an odd-looking Aether member invites me to the Hano Resort after my grand trial. They leave, but the Team Skull admin, Plumeria, surprises me with the battle soon after. As soon as she's defeated, I see Lily and Olivia at the ruins. I have my grand trial with Olivia, and I head to Hano Resort afterwards. When I get there, I find the weird dude from before, Faba, and he takes me and Hal to the Aether Paradise. There we meet Wick and the Aether President, Lusamine, who I think loves Pokemon a bit too much. In the middle of our meeting, an ultra wormhole appears and a mysterious creature pops out of it. I battle the being, and afterwards, Lusamine promises to see it again and help it. Me and Hal are escorted off the paradise and onto Ula Ula Island. He then catches me off guard with a battle where his Raichu fucks my team up. Next, I find Kukui in Mali Gardens and I follow him up to the observatory. I take a quick detour down the mountain to catch a mini-or named Orpal right before challenging the electric trial in the observatory. I defeat Totem Vikavolt and head back to Mali Gardens, where I find Kukui and the boss of Team Skull, Guzma. Guzma says he'll beat me down, but Taxidermy made sure that didn't happen, and I move on to Route 11. I run into Gladion on the way, and he tells us that Team Skull is trying to get their hands on Cosmog and that we need to protect it. Once I make it past that, I end up at the Aether House near Tapu Village. Inside the house, the captain, Acarola, tells me to face the trial down at the old supermarket. As soon as I leave the house to do that, I see Lily outside being harassed by Team Skull, and I White Knight for her. With Lily saved, I take on the Ghost Trial and Totem Mimikyu. After my victory, I go back to the Aether House and battle against Plumeria, who tells us to go to Po-Town in order to save a stolen Young Goose. I surf on a newly acquired Sharpedo across Route 15 and then trek on up to Po-Town from there. Outside the gates, we meet Nanu, who helps us get inside. After a long gauntlet of Team Skull grunts, I finally make it to Guzma's room inside the mansion, and we beat him to retrieve the Young Goose. Nanu is waiting for me outside the mansion, and Acarola appears to pick up Young Goose. I follow her back to the Aether House once more. However, when I get there, everyone is in panic because Lily has been taken by Plumeria and Team Skull. Gladion bursts in immediately after we hear this news, and battles me out of anger that we couldn't protect Lily. He calms down, but demands we follow him to help find her. On the docks, I have a surprise battle with the kahuna, Nanu, right before Gladion takes us to the Aether Paradise. He says that Lily should be here, but doesn't go into why. After battling through Faba and his Aether employees, we make it out onto the main floor and find Team Skull in cahoots with Aether. I have one more battle with Guzma in front of the doors to Lusamine's house, and am finally able to make it to where Lily is being held. It turns out Lily is Lusamine's daughter, or at least, according to Lily she is, because Lusamine has apparently disowned her ever since she stole Cosmog from Aether Foundation. Lusamine then goes to a secret room where she uses Cosmog to open the Ultra Wormhole. I try to stop her in a Pokemon battle, but fail, so she hops into the portal with Guzma to be with the Ultra Beast. Once all the calamity is over, we see that Nebby has transformed, have a brief rest, and begin our journey to get Lusamine back. Before we depart, Gladion gives us the Sun Flute, which he found in Lusamine's room. The first part of our journey leads us to Seafolk Village on Pony Island. We find Hapu and go with her to the Ruins of Hope, where she officially becomes the Island Kahuna. She then tells us that the Moon Flute is being held at Exeggutor Island, so we take a boat ride to it. While there, I catch an Exeggutor nicknamed Good Times, have an oddly romantic moment with Lily, and acquire the Moon Flute. With the flute in hand, me and Lily start the trek up to the Altar of the Moon. Before we can get too far, we're stopped by battles from both Team Skull and Hapu. Me and Lily take on the long and arduous path ahead of us, and one Totem Kamo'o later, we finally arrive at the altar. We both stand on designated pedestals and play the Sun and Moon Flutes together. When we do, the altar opens up, summoning the legendary Pokemon, Lunala, who just so happens to be Nebby. Nebby then takes us through an ultra wormhole so we can finally save Guzma and Lusamine. However, Lusamine wants no part of it, so she fuses with the Ultra Beast Neolego and challenges me to one final battle. It was hard fought, but eventually she was defeated, and Nebby takes us all back to our dimension, where Hapu is waiting. Guzma and Hapu take an injured Lusamine away, but our business at the altar is not yet finished. Nebby requests that it joins me on our journey, so I obliged, making Lunala my final team member. With that, there's only one thing left to do. I head off to Mount Lanakila to face the Pokemon League. I'm challenged by Gladion at the base and Hal at the peak, both of whom I defeat. Finally, I'm inside the League, and here's how it went down. Hala couldn't touch my ghost types, so it was pretty easily done in. Olivia gave me a little more trouble, but I still came out with the victory. Acarola was no problem, as Nebby finished the job. Lastly, one Shell Smash and a few Power Gems from Orpal, and it was all over for Kahili. Finally, we climb the stairs to the throne and become Alola's first champion. But of course, that'd be too easy. Me and my team have one final obstacle before ultimately reaching our goal, Professor Kukui. Kukui put up one hell of a fight, but in the end, me and my team bested him, and I was entered into the Hall of Fame. Back in Iki Town, a party was held celebrating my victory. During it, me and Lily sneak off to the Ruins of Conflict to thank Tapu Koko, and I end up catching it. We head back and go to bed shortly after. The next day, Lily leaves to go on her own journey in Kanto, and me, Hao, and Kukui see her off in that final bittersweet moment. The best way to tackle this is to go down the line of several complaints I've heard about Sun and Moon's gameplay and offer rebuttals to each one. Firstly, Poker Ride. I'll discuss more about why exactly it's so good in a later section, but for now, just keep in mind that it fixes the HM system, so it'll gain some points in gameplay as well. Anyway, I can't believe I even have to talk about why Poker Ride is better than HMs, but through my years of internet discourse, I've unironically seen people claim HMs were better. Specifically, I've seen someone argue that choosing which moves and team members to replace was strategic and made the game more difficult. I think the best way to debunk this is with an analogy. Okay, let's say that the final battle with Cyrus is like building a shelf, and your party Pokemon are the tools you can use. HMs would be like forcing you to replace one of your tools with a rock. Let's say I choose to forego my hammer. While yes, I can drive in nails with a rock, it's slightly more frustrating and an arbitrary inconvenience. The difficulty of building that shelf should be figuring out how to put all the pieces together, not the fact that my toolset is needlessly limited. Another complaint, which I hear more often, is that Sun and Moon are too easy. Certain parts are a bit easier than in previous generations, but I actually think there's parts which are more difficult than any game before them, and that's the Totem Pokemon. Remember how I mentioned in my last review that people were getting tired of gym challenges? Well, I think one of the reasons people felt this way is because they posed no real challenge. To explain what I mean, let's quickly compare and contrast both a gym I've struggled with and a totem I've struggled with. Brawly is your average gym leader. His team is wholly unremarkable in its moveset, and he has Pokemon that any ordinary trainer could have. I struggled with this battle, not because his team was strategically better, but because I didn't have anything to deal with fighting types when I fought him. Now, let's look at Totem Wishiwashi. There are various aspects as to why I struggled with him. The totem boost in defense, its ability, its held item, its moveset, its SOS partner, and its moveset, all of these layered on top of each other created an entertaining and memorable challenge. The only thing I can say against totem Pokemon is that not all are created equal. In synopsis, totem Pokemon are leagues more interesting than any other battle we've had in the series up to this point, and it's a concept that just needs to be fully realized. It's not just the totem Pokemon either. There are several battles that can be tricky if you're unprepared for them. If after all that, you're still in the crowd that says these games are too easy, then I recommend you turn off the EXP share. I did a run like that once, and it brought back all the pointless grinding people, for some reason, love. The last argument I often hear against Sun and Moon is how much it interrupts you with dialogue and cutscenes. I briefly touched on this in the Black and White video, and I said something along the lines of, it's not a problem because it serves to improve the plot and characters. While I still mostly hold that sentiment, I can see how it's a bit irritating. However, is it as big of a problem as people say it is? No. After the first trial, it's basically on the same level as Black and White with how much it cuts you off. Don't get me wrong, it would be nice to have a skip cutscene button, but compared to other gameplay dampeners before it, this is extremely mild. With all those counterpoints being stated, I only have one personal gripe with gameplay. That would be the lack of really good puzzles. There's a few minor things here and there, but for the most part, anything that could be classified as a puzzle is very easy and bare bones. Besides that, every other aspect of quintessential Pokemon gameplay is polished. From leveling to battling and catching, it's all at a point where I don't think any major improvements can be made. It just needs to expand on some of the concepts here, and it'll be perfect. Gameplay will earn a 95 out of 100. I'm gonna waste no time and jump right into what this section improves on from those before it. Now, on the surface, it may seem like they took the exact same approach as X and Y, of quality over quantity. But once you start getting a closer look at these guys, you really see how the designers improved upon that idea. So many of the Pokemon introduced in Gen 7 have some sort of niche to them. Almost every single one gets something that makes them stand out. It can be a signature move, a unique ability, an interesting type combination, or just good stats. Hell, I can point out a few that utilize several of these traits. Even Pokemon that most people pay no mind to stand out in some way. There's, of course, gonna be those Pokemon that get the short end of the stick, but for the most part, everyone has at least one thing going for them. The new Gen 7 Pokemon alone would be good enough as is, but Game Freak also introduced new forms of older Pokemon. These new forms are regional, meaning they're native variations of Pokemon from other regions. There's a healthy mix of both goofy and actually cool designs within the bunch added, and as someone who appreciates a silly guy from time to time, I love that. Speaking of wacky designs, the Ultra Beasts are an incredible new set of Pokemon. The idea of interdimensional Pokemon is super cool, and they execute it perfectly. Then there's the legendaries, specifically the Tapus. They have neat designs and I love how they fit in with the culture of Alola. That's all the new Pokemon out of the way, but what about the returning ones? I feel like I say this a lot, but there's a bit too many Gen 1 Pokemon here for my liking. However, there are some solid picks from other generations, so that makes up for it a little. With all that said and done, wait a minute! I almost forgot that this game introduces the world's greatest Pokemon! Everything about Toxapex is perfect, from the way you encounter it to its impeccable design. The cherry on top is its top-tier stats, which have been making competitive players seethe for the past 6 years. Pokemon selection earns an 88 out of 90. It's so close to perfect, but the old Pokemon selection isn't too great, and there are some less than incredible new Pokemon in the mix as well. Let's just start off with what anyone who has been following this series knows I'm about to talk about. Pokeride. It fixes pretty much every problem I had with HMs for the past 6 generations. No longer is there any needless moveset or team limitations. They just give you instant and convenient access to the abilities as soon as the designers want you to have them. They're also a lot more fun and immersive to use overall, barring maybe Machamp. I just wish they were utilized more, but that's more of a problem with the region than Pokeride itself. Another thing that fixes a previous complaint is the trials. The island trials are a concept unique to Alola, and are a very necessary breath of fresh air from the typical 8-gem format. They each have their own personality, but besides that, there's nothing too amazing within any of these. Despite that, I still like it for being different. Then there's Gen 7's gimmick, Z-moves. They may not be as cool as Mega Evolution, but their implementation is way better. Say what you want about them, but the fact you can use Z-power with pretty much any move in the game is a really nice touch. This gimmick isn't just limited to whichever Pokemon Game Freak decides deserves to have it, and I appreciate that about them. Also, when I say pretty much any move, I mean it. There are some exceptions, but a lot of the status moves have extra effects on top of their normal one when powered up with the Z-Stone. It's a small thing, but appreciated nonetheless. Z-moves are to Mega Evolution what SOS Pokemon are to Horde battles, except SOS battles are a bit more useful. They not only have the niche uses that Hordes did, but also more noticeable applications like with the Totem battles. They're a neat idea that's well executed. Next up, Pokepelago. It's a feature with a lot of utility. It makes tasks that you would have had to grind for in the past a lot more streamlined and convenient. Then you have the always present extra shit for fun. My favorite of these is the Battle Royale. I remember spending a good amount of time at the Battle Royale Dome back in the day. Besides that, there's Island Scan to get extra Pokemon, Hyper Training to boost IVs, and the Pokefinder if you're really bored, I guess. Oh, and lastly, new moves, abilities, and items. Always gotta mention those. Sun and Moon doesn't add a whole lot. But what it does add is either a useful change, an interesting new mechanic, or just something enjoyable to mess around with. Also, it's gonna lose points for online functionality being worse than an X and Y. Fuck you, Festival Plaza. 73 out of 80. The key factor that makes Sun and Moon's story work so well is how grounded it is for a Pokemon game. Every generation since 3 has had such intense stakes, and it's only really worked in the story's favor once. Sun and Moon lowers the threat level down a notch. Lusamine doesn't want to take over Alola or eliminate humanity. She's just obsessed with what she deems beautiful. There are consequences to opening the Ultra Wormholes, but the fact that they're more localized helps the story be able to switch tones without feeling awkward. My main problem with X and Y is how it tries to be a happy-go-lucky Pokemon journey with friends, but then hits you over the head with the ultimate weapon reveal. Gen 7 has no such issue. The threat isn't as existential, and the villains aren't straight-up evil. So it can be a lighthearted adventure while still having some serious character moments. Speaking of the villains, they are definitely the best characters in Sun and Moon, and it's for the exact reason I just stated. They aren't purely malicious. Lusamine's only flaw is that she's a narcissist whose obsessions poison her mind, both literally and figuratively. Guzma is just a guy with anger issues who wants respect from his peers, In a similar fashion, Aether and Team Skull can't really be classified as evil teams. They're both just full of misguided people. Alright, I think most people can agree that the antagonists are amazing, but how well do they handle the other characters? Starting off with the four most prominent, Lily, Hal, Gladion, and Kukui are all great. Each one has their own motivations and personality traits, which make them stand out, not just within Sun and Moon's story, but the game franchise as a whole. I also love the decision to make Kukui your final opponent of the Pokemon League. It makes complete sense given what we know about him, and allows for that champion battle to be one of the most impactful in the series. Hal is a character that I might get a lot of flack for not hating, but I frankly don't see the problem with him. I get that friendly rivals have become a meme at this point, but if you don't like it, then you have Gladion to fall back on as your more traditional rival. Hal is a completely inoffensive character at worst, and a chill dude who loves Malasadas at best. Finally, I can't fail to mention Lily. She's an interesting component of the story, who has a natural arc that progresses along your journey with her. Those four are all fine, but I think what really sets Sun and Moon apart is its cast of side characters. From Hala to Hapu, the trial captains and kahunas are all fan favorites, and it's not hard to see why. They each have just enough personality and screen time to make them charming in one way or another. Hell, even the less notable of the bunch like Fub or Molin are more memorable than your average gym leader. There really isn't a single character that I dislike. For that reason, and the plot being a good mix of carefree and dramatic, story and characters is going to earn a full 70 points. For a Pokemon game, it's perfect. Easily the weakest part of Sun and Moon is the region. It's very linear and doesn't offer a lot in terms of exploration, at least compared to previous games. Don't get me wrong, there's enough content here to suffice, but yeah, it's pretty underwhelming, especially areas like Mount Lanaquila. What Alola lacks in size, it more than makes up for in Seoul. In my last video, I talked about how each region had its own theme, and Alola's is being neighborly and full of tradition. So much culture is squeezed into the island and towns that it makes Alola probably the most distinct region we've ever gotten. Despite being a tropical climate like Hoenn, it still manages to stand out. Besides that, there's also plenty of memorable areas and routes. Aether Paradise is a particularly notable location. Finally, I've actually heard someone argue that Alola isn't Hawaiian enough, since you see a lot of immigration and architectural inspiration from regions scattered throughout. However, if you look up the demographics of Hawaii, this argument gets turned on its head. Overall, while Alola isn't packed with as much content as other games, I think it manages to make up for that a bit by having such a vibrant and unique identity. That gives the region a 45 out of 60. The soundtrack is once again perfect. My favorite part is all the Team Skull and Aether themes. That's it. Something I don't see talked about a lot is how good these games look. In Gen 6, 3D movement was still mostly limited to a grid, and the level design reflected this with how flat certain areas looked. The proportions of people in the overworld were also notoriously a bit silly. Sun and Moon fixes both of these things by doing a complete overhaul to how they designed the 3D environment. I think this is one of the reasons that Alola feels more linear and less fleshed out than those before it, but it's a step in the right direction. I also think that the art style is just better in general. Many places look vibrant, and it gives Alola a lot of charm. Not to mention, there's a lot of minutiae to the environments and battle backgrounds, which makes Sun and Moon that much more immersive. The frame rate can drop in certain areas, but I gotta praise Game Freak for pushing the 3DS to its limits. Next up is the postgame. It's still nowhere near something like Black and White, but at the same time, it does more than X and Y. The little it does have is all fun, too. The battle tree is a difficult enough challenge with old characters waiting for you at the top. Battle royales are an interesting diversion that I also spent many hours with. There are a ton of legendaries to catch, and the way you go about finding them is neat. You can defend your champion title, which is something unique to these games that I really enjoy. Besides those main things, there's all your typical small shit like collecting the extra Z crystals, exploring a few new areas, and grinding for items. This isn't an amazing postgame, but the fact I still spent so many hours in it without getting bored says something. Also, there's this neat scene with Guzman, Howley Beach, that contains some lore about him. Then, as always, I gotta mention the various quality of life changes. My favorite of these is the ability to tap a Pokemon on the touchscreen while in battle to see what stat changes or other effects are taking place. Last thing I want to bring up is that these games were only $40 when they first released. This was a pretty typical price, but I think it's a fair value, and you certainly get your money's worth. This point will become more important for a certain review in the near future, so I definitely had to put this in. Other receives a very respectable 40 out of 50, only losing points for having a relatively small postgame. Yep, just like Black and White 2, I'm doing a bonus round for Ultra Sun and Ultra Moon. They bring along their own slew of changes that make it just different enough to not throw into other. First up is the changes to gameplay. If you don't find Sun and Moon hard enough, Ultra does more than enough to fix that. So many battles are simply improved, and the leveling is just a tad better. The infamous Ultra Necrozma fight is one of the best examples of this game's difficulty. Also, remember way back in the gameplay section when I mentioned that totem battles needed to be fully realized? Well, the developers did exactly that. They really made the trials as a whole a lot more fleshed out. The only one I like less is the water trial because Lana doesn't have that quip about Kyogre anymore. On top of the trials, there's slightly more puzzles scattered throughout Alola here, so I appreciate that. The one thing that got worse was the number of mandatory tutorials. Once again, fuck you, Festival Plaza. Plus 1 point. For Pokemon selection, there's more of them. This includes a few new Ultra Beasts and a bunch of guys from previous generations. Nothing bad here at all. Plus 1 point. Mantine Surf, the Photo Club, and a few extra Z moves will gain new additions a couple of points. Gonna be honest, I do not like the story in Ultra compared to Sun and Moon. Lusamine is neutered, and they usurp her plot for the Necrozma one. She's still selfish, but not nearly as vile as before. And that's just no fun. At least the Ultra Recon Squad are fine additions. Anyway, maybe I'm just being autistic about the plot here. If anyone has their own thoughts, please let me know. Minus 1 point. There's overall more to do in the region. This includes fleshing out old areas and adding a few completely new ones. The best of these changes is with Mount Lanakila. Then you have all the different dimensions you can travel to. They're basically just glorified arenas, but the fact that we get to see them at all is awesome. Plus 2 points. There's two big additions to the postgame. Firstly, the Rainbow Rocket episode. It's only a couple of hours long in terms of gameplay, but damn if it isn't a cool concept. All of our favorite and least favorite villains have come from different dimensions where their plans succeeded. It's nice to see some of these guys back again, especially Getsis, who now abuses Lillian instead. The Rainbow Rocket episode offers boss battles with all those villains and some puzzles before you get to them, so it's just an all-around fun event. Next on the docket is Ultra Warp Ride. It's another great concept, and it's a pretty enjoyable minigame in general. This is also a much more interesting way to go about giving the player Ultra Beasts. I guess it's mainly just those two things, but there's also more little tasks to go around the region and complete. Anyway, they all make postgame much better as a whole. Plus 5 points, and with that, we can finally get our total score. After summing all of the points earned in various sections, the final score comes out to be 471 out of 500, or about a 94%. Alright, before I get any rioting in the comments, yes, that is 1 point above Black and White. However, I'm gonna let you guys in on something. I really don't care which of the two is better. I mean, of course I would say Sun and Moon is, but honestly, if someone claimed that Black and White were the superior games, I wouldn't argue with them. There's just no point in pitting two bad bitches against each other. Sun and Moon represent something special and personal for me. They're a nostalgic zeitgeist of the year they were released in. Things were simple, days were bright, and the cynicism of growing up hadn't yet set in. With that said, revisiting Pokemon Sun and Moon has taught me something. How to tackle the relationship between nostalgia and objectivity. It's fine to reminisce about what was great in the past, but we also need to be willing to take off the rose-tinted glasses for a moment and identify that which wasn't. Game Freak did this in a lot of ways with these games by fixing long-standing issues that were seen as staples of the Pokemon franchise. Should they keep doing this with future installments, Pokemon will surely continue to improve in the long run. The only way to find out if they do that is by reviewing the next games in the franchise, and final games in this series. It's been a long journey, but next time, I'm finally going to review Pokemon Sword and Pokemon Shield. I'll hopefully see you all there.